Thank you all. I'd like to call to order the special meeting of the Kenai Open Space Conservation Agency. This is August 2nd, 2006. Will you please join me in the salute to the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
May we have the roll call, please?
Vice Chair Berger?
Here.
Director Jacobson?
Here.
Chair Skay?
Here.
Fox and Bill De La Pena absent.
I believe Director Bill De La Pena will be joining us shortly, so you would reflect that when she comes in. Do we have any public comments on the items not on the agenda? I have three speaker cards for agenda item 4A, but any other public comments? Hearing none, we'll go straight to action item 4A, which is a request by Singular Wireless to install an underground vault access turnout, air vents, and retaining walls as part of a proposed wireless communication facility on Koska property in the Hillcrest open space at the base of a cut slope adjacent to a roadway located west of Westlake Boulevard, 610 feet north of Crest Haven Drive. Mr. Towne?
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the board. This item involves a wireless communications facility, which was first proposed on the south side of, or west side of Westlake Boulevard, just south of Crest Haven Drive, and was considered by the Planning Oaks, Thousand Oaks Planning Commission on January 23rd of this year. When I say facility, I'm describing a wireless facility that would involve an underground vault, as well as a ray dome, which is a structure that would enclose three antenna. It would be approximately 2 feet wide by about 5 feet tall. And this facility, as I mentioned, was first proposed considered by the Planning Commission. It was approved, however, subsequently appealed by a nearby resident to the City Council. And the City Council considered the matter on May 9th of this year. At that time, the City Council directed the applicant to consider locating the facility on open space north of Crest Haven. And to that end, Koska and city staff met with representatives of Singular in mid-June in that area to look at alternatives. And I should note that in May of the year 2000, the Koska board authorized staff to approve applications to the city for wireless proposals and to process minor access and utility easements related to projects already approved by the city for its land. However, in this case, we feel that this is a significant enough proposal that it should be heard directly by the board of directors. So having said that, the applicant first suggested a faux rock facility on the hillside just north of Crest Haven, and Koska staff did not support that alternative, and this is described on page 2 of your staff report. It was not supported by staff for several reasons. First of all, Koska has its own wireless communication facility policy, which is contained in Exhibit A of your packet, and in it you'll notice that it says that any facility in open space must be attached to an existing structure, and there are no structures in this area. Secondly, the site is in a natural condition with no rock outcrops, so a faux rock facility, in staff's opinion, would have diminished the open space character of the area. Finally, the area is zoned open space and protected ridgeline, and most of the slopes in the area are 30% to 40% slope. So the hillside areas would not be appropriate for construction based on the city's grading ordinance, and the ridgeline areas would not be appropriate based on the protected ridgeline overlay zone. So based on those factors as well, staff did not support the concept of a faux rock installation on the hillside. Pursuant to that discussion, staff and the applicant focused on a second option that would be on the west side of Westlake Boulevard just north of Crest Haven. And at that location, the facility would involve the underground vault, as I mentioned, and a ray dome mounted on a 35-foot tall monopole. In this area, the facility would be right next to the road. The vault would be partially on Koska property and partially within the public right-of-way. And it would involve a number of improvements, and these are enumerated on page 3 of the packet of the staff report. And those are as follows. The vault itself would be approximately 12 feet wide by 17 feet long and extend onto Koska property by about 5 feet 6 inches. The turnout for this area would have to be a bus-style turnout. And it was reviewed by Public Works staff, and they dictated that it would need to be approximately 130 feet long and also located partially in the public right-of-way. Retaining walls associated with this proposal would involve 2 6-foot-high retaining walls at the back of the turnout on Koska land. The first one would be 121 feet long, the second one approximately 82 feet long. And the upper retaining wall would extend onto Koska property by about 14 feet 6 inches. And that is the final as-built condition based on the preliminary plans. The monopole, as I mentioned, would be 35 feet tall and located about 7 feet from the Koska property line. The total area required for this proposal would be about 1,900 square feet, but that excludes the construction area that which would also be required for installation. Based on that, those facts of the proposal, staff put together the analysis contained on page 4 of your packet, and those include pros and cons. And the two pros associated with the proposal are that the retaining walls could be landscaped to make them somewhat less intrusive visually, and second, that any installation such as this on Koska property could provide, in fact, would provide revenue for open space needs in the community. However, on the con side, there were four principal factors that staff identified. The first is based on what I just described, and that is that this facility would have significant improvements, would require significant improvements on Koska land. And this is an area that, although it is a cut slope, it is a 1.5-to-1 gradient, and it appears to be in a natural state. And when I say significant improvements, that includes the retaining walls, the turnout, and the associated construction. Second, it's likely that the improvements would materially diminish the attractiveness of the site, and that is another key part of Koska's wireless policy that was adopted in 2000. An improvement of the scope of the size, staff believes, would have a significant impact on the attractiveness of this portion of Westlake Boulevard. Third is that the facility does not need to be located on Koska land for technical reasons. And again, Koska's policy on wireless facilities is predicated on the technical need for the facility to be located on Koska land. Finally, staff identified the issue of this potentially setting a precedent for similar facilities that may be proposed on Koska property, and that also was of concern. So in conclusion, staff's evaluation of this is that more than anything, it is a very significant proposal with significant improvements proposed for Koska land. These are far beyond anything that we have approved in the past. Koska does allow underground vaults on its property pursuant to its policy, as again included in Exhibit A of the staff report. However, the two vaults that Koska currently has on its property, neither of those involved anything near the extent of improvements that we're talking about here. Neither of those sites involved any significant grading beyond the area needed for the vault. Neither involved retaining walls. Neither involved any type of access improvements, because the access road to those two sites already existed. In this case, obviously, a significant turnout would be required, and also, again, even in the earlier concept of a faux rock installation on the hillside, there is no road in that area, so a road would need to have been graded to that site. So in conclusion, staff's recommendation to the board is not to authorize Singular Wireless to file the proposed application on Koska property. As property owner, you have that right to do that, and that is, again, based on the reasons that I've enumerated, which are in turn founded in Koska's policy on wireless communication facilities. And with that, I would be happy to answer any questions, as well as other staff.
Are there questions of Mr. Town before we go to the speakers? Director Bill De La Pena.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good evening, Mr. Town. It's nice to be sitting next to you tonight.
Good evening.
The question I have is, did we inquire as to why it was necessary to do all the grading compared to some of the other wireless facilities which don't or are not in need of such grading?
Right. The main reason is the topography of the site. That's shown in Exhibit E of the staff report. The cut slope behind the proposed location on the west side of Westlake Boulevard is a 1.5-to-1 manufactured slope that was built in the early 70s as part of the improvements for Westlake Boulevard. And so it's a very steep slope, and therefore that combined with the area needed for the vault and for the turnout requires the significant amount of grading that we're talking about. The other two sites that I mentioned are both in open space off the end of Grissom Avenue, and both of the sites are relatively flat, do not have any of the topographic challenges that this site does.
So if it weren't for the topography, we wouldn't have an issue? Do the other wireless facilities have the exact same amount and size of vault and other equipment?
I can't say definitively that they have the exact same size vault. They were put in some time ago, I would say approximately 1997. So they could be of a different size, but those vaults are both underground and have just minor equipment cabinets above grade. So, yes, it's not really an issue of the vaults on Koska property. It's really an issue here of the fact that we have a steep slope compared to other sites, which are relatively flat.
So the size of the vault and the equipment does play a very little role, small role?
I think the size of the vault plays a small role, but the other significant factor here is that of the turnout. The Public Works Department did require that the turnout be sized basically to accommodate a typical bus turnout, and that's because for maintenance reasons, one may need two vans stacked in this turnout, and as we know, Westlake Boulevard in this area can have relatively high car velocities. And so we needed to provide a safe turnout for those vehicles to service the proposed improvements. So that's the other main difference in terms of grading. It's a steep topography and the fact that Public Works is requiring this turnout to provide access to the vault.
Did you receive any photographs or renderings of the rock, fake rock formation to see what it would look like?
No, we really didn't receive those, but in part it's because we didn't ask for those. When we first looked at that alternative, we considered it in the context of there not being, again, any structures up there to attach the antennas to, but moreover, a faux rock installation in there we felt would appear out of place because there are no natural rock formations in the area. If this, for instance, were in the north part of North Ranch, where we have extensive sandstone outcrops, one could relatively easily conceal a facility like this in and among the existing rock outcrops. But in this area, it is coastal sage scrub throughout the hillside without trees, without any rock formations that one could try to conceal such an installation within.
Thank you.
Other questions, Mr. Town?
Let's go to our speaker cards. Richard Monroe, did you wish to go first? That's fine. Robert Jeistad?
That's correct. Do I have a time limit for speaking?
There's.
Okay, great. Thank you. My name is Robert Jeistad. I'm outside Council for Singular Wireless. With me tonight are Adrian Patnod, who's a site acquisition expert, and Rich Monroe, who is our RF engineer for the site, in case you have any questions for either of them. I very much appreciate the fact that you scheduled this special meeting when we know many of us would rather be in the dog days of summer on vacation or someplace else. So thank you very, very much. Our hope, obviously, is to get back to council as soon as possible so that we can discuss the possibility of this site, if you decide to approve it, as compared to the site that we've proposed previously. I don't want to repeat any sort of history or specifics that Mr. Town already went over. I don't think we want to take too much time with that. If you have specific questions, again, we are available. I would like, if I could, to respond to a couple. Well, first, actually, hand me the photo, sir. It's the photo. We just for convenience sake, this is not a photo simulation of the site, but it is a picture that shows the area that we would be working on. just to be very clear, what we are proposing here is a slimline monopole. We discussed the possibility of a light standard, one that would match the light standard that is now at Cresthaven, and Public Works prefers that we not have a light standard at this location. So they were supportive of a 35-foot slimline monopole, which would have a 66-inch radome at the top of it included within the 35 feet. So the top of the entire structure, the height of the entire structure is 35 feet. Our original proposal was to place the same size radome on top of an existing light standard at the corner of Cresthaven and Westlake Boulevard. And in light of some questions raised by a resident, obviously we're here tonight considering what may be a possible alternative to that site. Singular is supportive of either alternative. And obviously we would go back to council and be willing to go either direction. With regard to some of the cons about the monopole, just some thoughts for purposes of discussion. We understand your concern about the attractiveness of the site and the impact this could have to the attractiveness of the site. If you look at the existing site, it's fairly close to a residential lot that has some landscaping, and there is some right-of-way landscaping that, in fact, is just to the south of this. So in some sense, I mean, we're right on the corner of where the open space abuts against that residential property, and the landscaping could parallel or reflect the existing landscaping and kind of blend into the side of the hill. With regard to obviously whether or not, you know, technically this site is needed or not, that depends on our ability to get one of these two sites approved. It's not needed if the Cresthaven site is approved, but if the Cresthaven site is not approved, we have a technical need, and that's been established. With regard to precedent, you know, it's possible you could craft this as an exception to the policy and not treat it as a modification of the policy in light of the specific, you know, topographical constraints, the fact of existing cut and fill. There may be ways to cast this so that you minimize the precedential impact of the decision. And then finally, with regard to sort of overall a comparison between this site and the original site, we do want to say that, you know, obviously the grading, the turnout is a direct result of safety issues related to the location of this site on Westlake Boulevard, because as Mr. Town indicated, I mean, the velocity of cars in this area is in the 50 to 60, if not even higher range. And from our perspective, the original site at Cresthaven actually is significantly safer than this site would be even with the turnout. So with regard to issues of safety, we do have a preference. But Public Works has looked at this. They've given us some indication that if we were to be able to build this particular turnout, that they would be satisfied with regard to traffic impacts. And again, from our purposes, perspective, one way or the other, we would like this site or the original site at Cresthaven.
When I looked at the maps before the meeting, it had indicated that the monopole was going to go on the side of the road. This looks like it's in the center. It's on the side, isn't it?
It is on the
east side.
Yeah. That's right. Okay.
Director Jacobson.
Obviously, we're not privy to the information that was provided to the City Council and which became the basis for narrowing of various sites, and therefore we're not aware of why this site, in comparison to all others, appeared to be one of the most desirable sites. However, on the basis of looking at this site only because it's on Koska property and not being privy to any of the other considerations on any alternative sites. I guess my question is, why did you select this site? I can think of so many other pieces of Koska property where installation of a similar facility would probably not infringe upon adjacent homeowners or have any adverse impacts on neighbors. Is this limited by geographically having to locate these cells or whatever they're called within a certain certain area adjacent to the proposed location?
Yeah, exactly.
I see.
We have an RF engineer here who can answer that. I think that lends itself towards a technical response. This particular area, because of the topography is very, very difficult to serve. And if you drive through that area now and you're a singular customer, you will lose your signal. There is no signal in this area. Our opportunities for sites in this area are very, very limited. We've done an extensive alternative site analysis and considered sites higher up the road, further down the road. There are hills that would impede the possibility of placing sites, you know, on certain transmission or utility easements that are at the top of the hill. So we need to have a facility located within this general area. The perfect site, and this is very close to it, so from an RF perspective, I think we're still very satisfied with it. But the perfect site is at Crest Haven, at the corner of Crest Haven and Westlake Boulevard. Because we have an existing facility, but the idea again is to cover this gap in coverage that is in this recessed area on Westlake Boulevard and adjacent residential areas. But Rich, if you want to add something.
Mr. Monroe, did you wish to come up and?
Well, he's doing such a good job of it. I don't want to confuse the issue.
Thanks. Your questions are directed to a technical response, and in the process of building a cellular system, it got its name from being built like six-sided honeycomb cells, and with the height dictation limitation, the cell can only be a given size. In this area, we're talking about 35 feet, which gives you approximately a 4,000-foot range, 2,000 each side of the cell site. If you take that into consideration that you are attempting to cover down towards Thousand Oaks Boulevard and on up towards the golf course, you'll find that this cell site by itself is not going to solve all of the issues. But the size of it and the center of it are dictated by the need to cover RF-wise, and if you move them close together in another direction, you overlap, you create interference for yourself, you create interference for the user that doesn't allow the system to function properly. So the location is dictated by the available resources and the topography. And it sets itself in such a way that this particular site is interstitial between a proposed site just north of Thousand Oaks Boulevard and a proposed site. And when I say proposed, they are not brought before you in an application process, but as an RF engineer and 35-foot limitation, I have to figure out how to place these sites. So in my mind, I require one south of it, I require one north of it. And as you juggle these around, they don't go more than that 4,000 feet when you attempt to give service to a community that may use that in their house as well as on the open ground. And the fact that that's in the center of a valley, the east being a rather steep area and the west being a rather steep area, it's a canyon illumination that you accomplish by putting the antenna at that height and then pointing it up and down the street. Have I answered your question, sir?
Sites, that is the responsibility unless it's proposed for those additional sites,
that may be located on Costco land.
Nevertheless, the other agency here, the city, is the one that will consider your other alternatives and what have you. And my question, even though I'm concerned, because I am equally frustrated on the use of cell phones at times, but my concern is solely on this particular site, because it's before us as the agency that is to give it consideration. I do have other comments and questions, but you've answered the technical question I had, and that is that it appears you have, this is only one of possibly other sites that may be brought before some agency here within the valley. Is that correct?
I have broached that subject, yes, sir. I did it to give you information that relates to where, why this is located specifically, where it is. It isn't by no means a plead, an application, or anything else. It's my technical response, and I understand your concern about my bringing it up, and I do not intend it in any way to be a point of discussion. It's necessary from a technical standpoint to show you that the range of these cell sites is not sufficient to cover extremely long distances when you are restricted in antenna height.
I appreciate that. You answered my question very thoroughly. Thank you.
Mr. Monroe, did you have, oh, I'd say Director Berger has a question.
I think I better stand still for a minute.
I don't know if I direct this to Mark or to the speakers. If you're Singular, if Singular is having a problem with signals there, then Nextel is, AT&T, well, AT&T is Singular now, whatever other ones there are out there. So does this mean, Mark, that once this, if this were to be approved, then those three or four other providers in town, like I said, Nextel, Verizon and so forth, T-Mobile, will then be asking to put a similar thing up in the same area?
I may defer this one to our city attorney, Amy Albano, if you have any.
I don't know that I'm better equipped to answer it, but Madam Chair, members of the board, members of the public, we really don't know what their needs are. All of the companies have cell sites in different locations. I know that two of them are located not that far from there on a co-location, which is why Singular, sort of being the last guy in this area, couldn't be on that other place that was current. I mean, if Singular goes there, is there an argument that someone else might want to come and co-locate with them? That's always a possibility. But we don't have anything else pending that we know of. And I think what we really want you to try to think about tonight in terms of where the discussion is, in terms of precedent, I believe what Mr. Town was really concerned about was the precedent anywhere else in the city of doing such extensive work, because we haven't allowed that in the past. And for your purposes, is that there is the argument that technically it could be needed if another site isn't available. But more, I think the question for you isn't what's more appropriate or isn't, but whether this is something you want to see, this kind of expansion of use on open space, in a nutshell. So I hope that helps.
Yes, thank you. Mr. Monroe, did you have any other comments?
No, I...
All right. Okay. Thank you very much. Adrian Patnod? I hope I didn't...
Patnod.
Patnod. Okay.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the board. My name is Adrienne Patnod. I work with Infernex, and I'm the site acquisition representative for Singular Wireless. Been involved with this site and this location for some time, so I can provide you with any background or history that you might have. One thing that I would like to mention is that during the city council meeting that we attended, the question was specifically asked if we had considered locating the facility on the Costco property initially. And my response was that at the time it wasn't, because we were aware that you had certain policies and guidelines that dictated the types of uses that you would approve. But at the council's direction, we were asked to specifically take a look at this property and see if there was some way that we could propose a facility that the COSCA board might be willing to consider and approve, even if it meant some sort of exception to your existing policies. So that's why we're here this evening. I think staff has done an excellent job of describing the project, and Bob's provided some additional background. So really, I'm just here to answer any additional questions that you might have.
Okay, thank you. Any questions of Ms. Patnott? Yes. Director Bildelapena.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good evening, Mrs. Patnott. I was wondering if you could refresh my recollection or my memory. As I recall, the coverage of that area was weak. Not that there was no coverage, but that it was weak coverage. That was my recollection looking at the map that showed all of the areas and gaps.
My understanding from talking with some singular customers is that there are areas where there is no coverage in that location. For example, when we've been on the site, it's not been possible for us to place a call in that location. We have to get in our cars and leave to generate a call. So Rich could probably respond more to the technical questions about existing coverage and the need for the coverage than I can.
As I recall, the council did discuss whether this was a capacity versus coverage issue, and this was clearly a...
Member Skay, this is what, when I was trying to frame the issue, I'm sorry to interrupt, but it's really beyond what's in front of COSCA for COSCA purposes. That's why I'm trying to get you to look at it from terms of, as a property owner with certain goals to protect the open space and your interests, all you're doing is tonight is that the really the question you're asking yourselves is this something we'd want to see in our property? And I guess what I'm trying to say to you is that it meets, there's a con as to the technical, but there's also a pro as to whether, because the language in our policy, I'm sorry if you give me 1 second, says to locate such facilities there for technical reasons, that there is a technical reason to have it placed at that location as well as a location south of there at Crest Haven. And we don't go into lots of details of whether it's, you know, coverage issue or different issue, because I think what's really before, because that will be something the council can deal with. And those are the kind of questions that they have to ask. So I think what's really important for you at this point is to, in terms of whether this is something that you feel falls within your policy or that you're willing to believe that it falls within your policy and that you're willing to go ahead and support. Because even if you did that tonight, if you acted to say that we would allow an application for this facility on COSCA land, it would still end up back at the city to process that and go through public hearings and all those other things about that. So I guess I'm trying to, so that we don't confuse the issues too much of the technical, is trying to get us to look at the broader policy implication, I guess.
Oh, I appreciate that. Ms. Albano, is that helpful?
Well, the reason I brought it up is because the speaker mentioned that there was no coverage, and I wanted to counter that. And also, the wireless communications policy that COSCA adopted does state that we shall closely adhere to the City of Thousand Oaks' policy regarding such facilities. It does not say that I can't talk about anything else. The City of Thousand Oaks policy does include coverage and capacity. And our policy states that we must adhere closely to that policy, which is the reason I brought it up.
I'm sorry. It says all wireless communication facilities shall closely adhere to the City of Thousand Oaks policy regarding such facilities in open space zone, not the entire Thousand Oaks policy, due to the sensitive scenic. And what the we have Pam here, who's from our planning department. Because if you remember the way the city's policy, which I have in front of me somewhere, you know, sort of lays out a hierarchy of where things should be located. And I, there is a special use permit is needed for OS zones, and there is a hierarchy, but it really has to go with the protection of it being in an open space versus whether there is ultimately a need. I think that that's why we use that term sort of technical need, not in the sense of what you go through under federal law, because all you're doing, you're acting as a landlord here more than...
We're not trying to assess the...
Right, to assess the needs or anything else. You're really doing it. So if this had been like some of our other ones that have come before you, you wouldn't even see it because staff approves them because it's attached to an existing or it's underground and it doesn't matter. I mean, we have one pending with another carrier that actually I believe has been approved by the Planning Commission already. It's gone through the whole process. But it was all processed by staff because it fell within our parameters, whereas this is something different.
If I may interrupt, since we have Ms. Patnaud standing at the podium.
Okay.
Did you have anything else you wish to state, Ms.
Patnaud? At this time.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Ms. Albano, is there...
No.
Did you have more to go? All right. Director Berger.
In other words, it looks like our policy in the year 2000, almost 6 years ago, exactly, was to set a guideline. We felt at that time, with no particular site in mind, that it's the guidelines with which we would like to operate the whole thing. In other words, all of our open space as far as the cell towers go. Reading that and just focusing like Ms. Albano is suggesting, it obviously does not fall within those guidelines. It's a matter of interpreting that policy, and now the question would be, do we want to allow an exception to that policy? I think that's the bottom line right there.
Are there other questions of staff, or is there a motion? Director Jacobson.
Before we have a motion, we will have consideration and discussion at the board level. Is that correct?
Well, typically you would make the motion and then discuss the motion. But if you had other questions of Ms. Albano or the speakers or Mr. Town, this would be the time.
No, I have no questions. I'll wait until we have discussion.
All right.
I did forget to ask whether the residents in that area were notified of this particular meeting, the residents who initially opposed this?
No, staff did not notify the appellants in this case. We did provide all of the normal notification for a COSCA board meeting to the press and public postings and so forth, because we looked at this really as a COSCA policy issue rather than a public hearing. If it were a public hearing, as you deal with routinely as a council member, it requires a very specific amount of notification to the entire neighborhood. And this case was really one, as Ms. Albano has pointed out, is a case really of consistency between this proposal and the COSCA policy on wireless facilities. If the board opts not to support it, then it's a moot point in that sense. And as Ms. Albano mentioned also, if the board does want to consider this site, then it would go to full public hearing in any case.
Thank you.
Back to the City Council with full notification.
Thank you. Mr. Berger?
I'm willing to move staff recommendation.
And all right, and the staff recommendation is
for
that
not
the Board of Directors not approve the request to use COSCA property for a wireless communication facility. All right, is there discussion on the motion? Mr. Jacobson?
I always hate to be tied into a policy as if it's permanent, cannot be compromised in any manner or not. So argument four, where it says under the cons that it could be seen as a precedent, I think that maybe with the passage of time and what have you, there is a need for modification of the facilities to consider something that might be more in keeping with the capabilities of cellular systems as they are now. So the fact that it's seen as a precedent, if we had allowed it, and that's not within the motion, I don't look on as a valid argument because times change and situations change, so that what might be a given argument that, well, there's a policy against it, doesn't always have merit. I do support the motion as presented. I do so because I think that it is an intensively used area, both visually with people passing by and what have you, and it would infringe to a degree on what otherwise is a very aesthetic area. And for that reason, the con arguments 1, 2, and 3 are very appropriate, and I would support the motion and the basis of those arguments.
Other comments or discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion to not approve the request, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? Very good. All right, thank you, and thank you very much for coming. We appreciate your thorough explanations. So that was our only action item, and that brings us to board member comments. And I actually have a comment. Some of you may be aware that COSCA's been in existence for close to 30 years, I think 29 years this summer, if I'm correct. And Mr. Tex Ward has been the guiding light all that time. In fact, he was the, I don't know if everyone realizes this, but COSCA was Texas' brainchild to form a joint powers agency with the city and the park district strictly for the purposes of having an open space focus, an agency directly focused on open space here in the Caneo Valley. And it was unique at that time, and it's still relatively unique. This is Texas' last official meeting as general manager of the park district, and when we see him heretofore, it may be in the audience, and he will be as general manager emeritus. So we do want to have, I'm sure we, I think I will not be stepping out of bounds when I say COSCA fully intends to have a truly appropriate and thorough send-off for Mr. Ward at some point in the future, whether he likes it or not, and whether it's in this forum or some other venue. I think we have a lot of things we want to say to you, but there may be some brief comments that people would like to say now, and I think, Mark, you wanted to lead off.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, I mean, as a colleague, Tex, I would just like to thank you for all the work that you've done for Open Space over the years. It really has been both a pleasure and a privilege to work with you. And as I began to think about your impending departure, just a few projects came to mind that Mr. Ward has been directly involved in, or should I dare say play the pivotal role in terms of open space and related acquisitions, just a few of which include Wildwood Park in 1967, about 1,300 acres of land at that time, since grown to about 1,700. The Hope Nature Preserve in 1976, an area of about 350 acres, which Mr. Ward negotiated in terms of it being donated to the park district at that time.
By Bob Hope.
By Bob and Dolores Hope themselves.
Mr. T.
So, obviously significant. The small but beautiful McRae Wildlife Preserve. In a 75-acre area on the Norwegian Grade in 1981. The Wildwood Mesa deal in 1987 that preserved 225 acres, which I think is probably the most heavily used area in our entire open space system. Any day of the week, you can find families and individuals there on horseback and hiking and on bicycles enjoying it. And then more recent projects, Rancho Potrero in 1993, acquisition of that property, 640 acres, most of which will be preserved as open space, and then the more recent McRae Ranch acquisition in 1995. Obviously, that has many historic features, but it also has a significant open space component. So just these six projects that immediately came to mind total about 3,000 acres that Tex was directly involved in preserving, 3,000 acres of land. That is a huge amount of territory. And so, again, it's really been a pleasure, and I look forward to seeing you in the future. Thanks.
And I know the Park Board is saving up all their comments for tomorrow night.
well, I will make a comment here, if I may.
As a relatively young park board member back in the mid-'80s. First real hard negotiating meeting that I had to go to with, as a COSCA member, or at least representing the park district, was the Wildwood Mesa. And the first deal that the developers gave, I thought, God, this sounds great, you know? And Tex goes, no. And it ended up being much greater, and I learned so much. In other words, just keep my mouth shut and let Tex do it. But I learned so much just from that one meeting, and wow, it was, I appreciate all Tex has done, and there's a lot of stuff here, Tex. Thanks a lot. And it also ties into the MRCA, which is a joint agency with the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy, Rancho Simi Park District, and Canal Recreation and Park District. And that this, I believe, the COSCA was kind of the role model for the MRCA. So, thanks, Tex.
Yeah, Tex, as you all know, has a very quiet way of getting things done. And this valley is green, if you look at how we color our maps, because of Tex Ward.
And learned it all from John
Prescott. Who's not here to defend himself. He's just a whippersnapper. He's and in fact, I have to, I don't know if I owe it to Tex or if I'm going to have to get retribution, but I'm involved in a lot of this stuff because somehow he found out about my master's thesis and called me up one day and sort of got me involved in the open space issues here in the valley. And so it's all your fault, Tex. Oh, it was a study of the Arroyo Conejo Canyons. It's done around the same time that the city was doing their study. Mine was a little bit of a broader topic. So there we go. And we're all shocked that you're actually riding off into the sunset, as it were. Well, not exactly. You're going to be around. We're all shocked that you're retiring. It's just something that no one really contemplated, but we're glad that it looks like you will have the title of General Manager Emeritus if the rest of the Caneo board, right, if all goes right tomorrow night. So we won't say goodbye. We'll just say see you later. Yes. Oh,
I'm sorry. I didn't realize that today was going to be your last official night as General Manager of the Park District. Congratulations, obviously, are in order. And as Rory Skay mentioned, we will see you literally riding off into the sunset, Wyoming perhaps, or here in the Conejo Valley. And in the couple of years that I have worked with you, I have found you to be extremely approachable, and it's been a pleasure to work with you. And obviously you have been a driving force in protecting open space in the Conejo Valley, and that is very much appreciated. Congratulations.
Tex, you have to make a speech.
Well, I'm going to save my rebuttal for a later time. Well, thank you all for the nice comments. Actually, I have another meeting tomorrow night with the board of directors, which will be the 38 years of board meetings. So that's going to be kind of bittersweet. And I will be I'll be in the area keeping an eye on things. And I've been kind of working back and forth, cleaning things out, and there is a very interesting history as to how we got to the point that the last COSCA meeting we spent on wireless communication.
The irony.
Just going back from my graduate degree in open space and planning and Caneo Valley, when I first came, they put me on the Committee of 100 to do the general plan in 1968, and that was an experience. We learned a lot. Open space was kind of an issue, but you just kind of color it green on the map and say it'll take care of itself. To questioning that between city planning and park district, to developing a cost-benefit study, just to look at what would happen if it were publicly owned, what it was going to cost, The planning department did an excellent report called the Conejo Canyon Study, which identified further issues. Conejo Future Foundation did a white paper on open space. There were at least two committees meeting on Saturday for, gosh, I don't know, 3 or 4 years, talking about open space in general, and kind of all came down to, this is all very good, but who's going to do it? And that's how we got to the point of taking the resources of the city, the resources of the district, putting those together, developing some synergy. And Chair Skay coined the best phrase that I can think of, which is a botanical phrase that I think applies to COSCA. We have hybrid vigor, which means you take two entities, put them together, and they're better than what you had to start with. And I think that's where COSCA is. I think COSCA has more to do, and I will be around. I'm not leaving town, and I appreciate all the support of the COSCA board members, the city staff, going back to Glenn Kendall, who didn't want to do it, but was kind of pushed into it. Two great elected officials at the time, Francis Prince, Doris Granholm, were on a subcommittee working through those issues. Phil Gatch was my ally in the city to bring that together, and was ultimately adopted in spite of the council person at the time who did eventually vote yes, but called it a two-headed monster, and I sometimes it feels like that, but it's not really. So anyway, that's my off-the-cuff little speech, and I do appreciate your comments.
Well, hear, hear. Okay, well, we'll adjourn to the September 13th meeting of COSCA and future parties to honor techs. Thank you all.